Hey, Jonathan here. In this video, I'm going to be talking about R versus Python for data analytics and data science. And I thought it was important to make this video because there's been a lot of great information, but I just thought it's maybe a little incomplete, a little imbalanced about which tools should actually be used.
If you're new to this channel and you're keen to learn the latest tips, tricks, and tools for working more effectively with data, please hit the subscribe button for weekly videos.
Now, R and Python are both fantastic tools. And in some circumstances, R is a much, much better tool. And in some circumstances, Python is a much, much, much better tool. So the question is, you know, which is the right tool for you? And this is important, I think, because at the end of the day, we need to make data more accessible to more people. Not necessarily just PhDs, not necessarily just software engineers. The world is becoming data-driven. And so it's important, aside from just kind of R and Python and stuff as well, that we make data analytics and data science more accessible to more people. Now, I wanted to start off by saying that the rise of R and Python has been absolutely fantastic. Obviously, they are both open source tools, which means they're free, and they have been massively extended through tens of thousands of libraries, which do a ton of work for you automatically, which is absolutely incredible. Now, compare this to what you used to need to use, things like MATLAB, SAS, and SPSS, which are great, but massively expensive tools. And the other thing is, besides the initial cost of the actual tool, was the fact that the power of these tools often comes through all of these additional libraries. And if you needed to get any of these libraries for these tools, that would be additional license cost as well, which just made them like really difficult to actually do anything at any pace. If you need to get like cost approvals or any of that sort of thing. Whereas with R and Python, you type in a short command and within seconds, you've got your library installed and you're ready to go. So, key benefit there of both being open source. Now, let's go back and talk a bit about, fundamentally, Python is a general purpose programming language. So it's been around for longer than R, and it's used for a lot more things. So, in that respect, Python is a lot more popular in the kind of wider area of not just data science. So you can use it for everything, like running server maintenance scripts. You can use it to program your Raspberry Pi to like give yourself smart lights, to manage your cloud computing environments, as well as now data with the Pandas library. So, you know, Python is a very, very powerful tool, and it's got about 70,000 libraries or so, which do kind of all of these different things. Now, R, on the other hand, is a data-specific programming language. So, which means it's actually very, very nice for working with data. And it's only got 10,000 libraries, but instead of having, 10,000 libraries spread across like all of these kind of different functionalities and areas, it's got 10,000 libraries, which are very much focused around a data analyst, data scientist kind of process and workflow. So that's something to keep in mind as well, that if you are actually specifically working in data, there's some very, very nice libraries that maybe Python doesn't really have. Right. Now, so let me give you an example of that. So one of the things with Python is people say that, okay, well, you can take your analysis and turn it into a web application using things like Flask and Django. So these are kind of, really popular, well-established frameworks for Python, which allow you to build web applications. Now, the thing to keep in mind with this is that in order to use these, you kind of need to also be a web developer, right? So you need to know Flask or Django. You also need to know some HTML and some JavaScript, asynchronous programming concepts, like some reactive programming, all this kind of stuff, right? Now, if you have these skills, fantastic. That's great, right? A nice little thing to add to your CV, right? But the thing to keep in mind is that even if you do have these skills, it basically takes a lot, you know, it basically takes a bit of work to kind of actually build these things out. And it's almost like a kind of another job in itself. Whereas with R, a lot of people don't realize that you can actually build web applications as well. You can build reactive web applications actually very, very quickly, actually much faster than Python, using things like Shiny and Flex dashboards. Now, the cool thing about this is that your focus is predominantly as a data analyst. And a data analyst or data scientist. You want to be able to do your research and then you want to be able to quickly present it without necessarily needing to be a web developer or being dependent on a web developer to get your work out. And this is where R is just really, really powerful because you can basically just write markdown documents with a little bit of your R code embedded, and you can build reactive web applications. No HTML, no JavaScript, no learning of Flask or any of that kind of thing. And it is just unbelievably fast for doing it. Now, not as flexible, you know, you're not going to get a job as a web developer using things like R, Shiny Flex dashboards, but you're going to get out work a hell of a lot quicker. So even if you're into things like rapid prototyping and different things like that, R can actually be a really, really good option for that. So, you know, just something to keep in mind as well. Okay. Other things, like often people talk about how Python is basically for machine learning. And so the thing is this, R had machine learning libraries kind of well before Python. But the problem was is that because they were written by lots of different people, it was actually quite fragmented. And so when Python came out with scikit-learn, it was very, very kind of powerful because it created a single cohesive way for accessing like all the machine learning models. And you know, since then, Python has actually taken the front seat in terms of all the kind of different machine learning models which have been developed, access to the different APIs and everything like that on, you know, all the cloud computing environments. Python does take a front row seat to the machine learning models, which is, you know, which is an important thing to take into consideration, especially since machine learning is such a big thing right now. But the thing is that the R community is not sitting still on this either. They are rapidly developing and porting all of these libraries over as well. So, you know, you still have access to all your things like Keras and TensorFlow. You know, you've got access to automated machine learning models like H2O and everything like that. So there is still a lot of options on R as well, but typically it is, you know, just slightly behind Python, right, in this respect. So something to keep in mind there. Okay. So yeah, I just kind of mentioned kind of cloud computing and stuff as well. So right now with cloud computing, the kind of big thing is, you know, like now you can build, like do serverless programming and stuff like this, right? And I'll talk about that in probably another video sometime. But a lot of that basically uses Python to build all of these functions, which is kind of really powerful. A lot of all the API access and everything, again, is basically through Python, right? So Python is slightly better when it comes to this this respect, especially on AWS, which is kind of the kind of key player in the cloud computing space. Really, it's all Python. Now, but you've got other players as well. For instance, Microsoft Azure, they're kind of pretty much the second place player, and they're still a massive, massive contributor to the cloud computing space, and they do a ton of really, really good things. Like a lot of people don't realize that Microsoft Azure has actually much more machine learning, pre-built machine learning models than actually AWS does. So something to kind of keep in mind there. Microsoft also actually has much better support for R as well. So they have support for basically R and Python, knowing that, okay, well, these are the two big languages for data analytics and data science. So you've got things like Microsoft ML Server. It'll take R or Python code and then compile it and expose the stuff via a REST API, which you can then kind of run your stuff off, right? So really, really powerful stuff there. You've also got things like, Microsoft has a no-code machine learning, machine learning kind of builder where you can basically drag and drop processes onto kind of a workflow to build out machine learning models. And that also integrates with R or Python. So, you know, a bit better kind of R support there as well. So again, you've kind of got both options. Which kind of leads me on to my second, the kind of next point, which is about putting stuff into production. So a lot of times people say that, okay, well, if you want to put something into production, well, just use Python, right? Python is kind of the thing that you would use to put things into production. But again, that's not necessarily the case. Now, effectively, Python is a language which has been used a lot more by software developers, software engineers, and you know, so they're much more familiar with the whole process and workflow of getting stuff into production. Whereas R has typically been a language used by researchers and mathematicians and statisticians who are not necessarily software developers, and because of that, they're not really familiar with production workflows, right? So, you know, like people think, okay, well, R is just a bunch of scripts, which is, you know, not really that suitable. But actually, it's possible to expose, you know, you can containerize R functions into like Docker containers, and you can expose your functions via REST APIs and all this kind of stuff, right? So actually, there are actually a lot of options there for using either language in production. It's kind of more how you use the language rather than the actual language itself. All right, so the next point I wanted to cover off here is documentation and help files, and just basically, I guess, how easy each language is to learn. Now, again, as mentioned, Python is typically something which is already being used by software developers. And so because of that, if you already come from like a software developer kind of background, then, you know, potentially Python will be easier to pick up. Whereas R is, I'm going to say that R is easier for working with data than Python. And, you know, again, this is partially because it was natively built, right, as a language specifically for data analytics. Right. Also, I mean, the design considerations for both languages. Python was designed to be a easy to read, easy to understand language. R was designed to be a language which was very, very forgiving, which means you could write code in kind of lots of different ways and have it still work. Which, when you're getting started, actually makes a big difference. It actually helps a lot to get up and running, right? On the flip side of that, you know, sometimes people complain, it's like, oh, you know, this R code is just so messy because there's, you know, like instead of having one way to do something, you maybe have a dozen. I still suggest, like now, if you're learning R, I suggest learning Tidyverse as like a really, really, really good standard for using R. But even if you don't strictly adhere to it, your code will probably still work. And that is kind of nice. Now, in terms of help files and documentation, at least for the data side of things, I found the R documentation and help files to be much, much better. Now, part of this is the fact that the standards for R documentation, it requires like vignettes. So basically code samples and examples that can run. And now this really, really helps out a lot. Now, a lot of times with the Python libraries, you have a documentation file, it tells you what all the different kind of functions are, but it has no examples to help you along, which means, I don't know, maybe you have to go to Google or Stack Overflow, or whatever it is to try and look those up to try and figure those things out. Whereas R code, you know, you hit F1 right there on the function. You've got all the documentation and your code samples, which you basically copy paste and start using. And they have lots of nice little examples. And this actually really, really helps a lot to get up and running like really, really quickly. So, you know, important thing to take into consideration as well. Okay. Now the other thing I want to talk about is BI solutions. Now, you know, as mentioned before, Python has much better integration with things like cloud computing. You know, it has better support for like a lot of different APIs, which is also important. But R has got better support for BI tools, right? So a lot of your BI tools, like your Tableaus, your Power BIs, and all these kind of things that, you know, like a lot of businesses are already using to do their data analysis, they will have built-in R integration. But they probably don't have, well, I haven't seen Python integration as well. So something to kind of keep in mind there. So R is kind of integrated better in different kinds of ways, right? Okay. So which is right for you? I think probably the most important thing is what is the rest of your team using, right? Because if your team is using all R or they're using all Python, well, you should really just go off and learn that. But other than that, like Python is generally going to be better for kind of software developer teams, whereas R is going to be kind of be better for kind of researchers and analysts. Now, I'd say if you're kind of more business facing and not sitting in a software development department, then you know, you should really consider R as a tool, just because you can build, again, you can build everything from end to end, like very, very quickly, without needing to learn like a lot of other kind of skills and stuff as well. So again, with the web development, you can build a web application within minutes in R without HTML or JavaScript or Flask. You won't get as much control, but you know, you will be able to churn out stuff really quickly. Other things I forgot to kind of mention as well is that languages like SQL are very, very useful, very important for accessing data from databases and different things, right? So it's a good language to learn, and it's not too difficult to learn SQL. But if you learn R, you don't necessarily need to learn SQL either, because R has got database connectors, which allow you to basically just write your regular R code and have it run against databases and stuff as well, which is just kind of really nice because, again, you've got like one language that pretty much does, you know, that pretty much does everything in your workflow, right? I mean, again, like Python kind of overall does more things, but it's merged in with HTML and JavaScript and SQL and all these different things, which are, again, great skills to learn and know. But if your focus is as a data analyst or data scientist, you may not necessarily want to learn those. Or even if you do learn them, you may not necessarily want to spend time on them. Or, you know, even if, basically have dependence on other people with those skills to be able to get your work out. All right, so if you found this helpful, please give a thumbs up. Part of my mission is to try and help more people from different backgrounds and different starting points get involved in data. So if you want to get access to some free training, you can head over to my website, www.datastrategywithjonathan.com. And again, thanks for watching, and I will see you next time.